In this example, your cursor contains all of the words and definitions. There are a variety of ways to get information from your cursor object. And working with cursors returned from the content provider is exactly the same as working with cursors returned from the SQLite database. To help out though, I'm going to review a couple of key methods that you should know about now. I will also show you how to iterate through the rows inside of a cursor. You'll need to know how to do some of this to be able to finish up the exercise. The data of a cursor is tabular, as seen here. The data returned in your cursor is pretty simple. There are only three columns. A cursor has a position, which is the row that it's currently pointing to. When you first get your cursor back from the query method, it's positioned at row -1, which is nothing. When you call move to next, it moves the cursor to the next row that it can. And then it will either return true or false, depending on if the move was successful or not. So here, it would have returned true. And then every time you call move to next again, it will move the cursor one more row down. Again, here returning true each time. Now once you get to the final row, it won't be able to move the cursor anymore, and then it will return false. If you want to move the cursor somewhere else besides the next position, there are a few other move to methods. This includes, but isn't limited to, move to first, which moves the cursor back to the first row. Each column in the cursor has an index. When you're at a row, and you want to know some information, such as what word is at that row, it's important to know the column index. You can look up this column index by using the getColumnIndex method and passing the column heading. The column heading is found in the contract. Then, you can use one of the get methods to get the actual value. Which get method you use depends on the type of data that you're expecting to get back. For example, if you're getting a word, you'd use getString. If you're trying to get the ID, you'd use getInteger. Again, you need to pass in the column index. GetCount returns the number of rows that are in the cursor. And close should be called when you're done interacting with your cursor. If you don't do this, you could create a memory leak, which will leave nobody happy. Your app might crash, so just don't forget to do it. Here's a handy code snippet for iterating over all of the rows in a cursor and then finally printing out what was in the table. It contains some of the methods that we just saw. Let's take a look at it in the code. So here I've typed the code snippet in our actual code. I put it in the onPostExecute method so that I have the cursor available to me. These first two lines of code are simply using the getColumnIndex method to get the index of the word and definition column. I use constants from the contract class to be able to actually look these up. This loop here will move the cursor from row to row. And for each row, it gets the value of the word at that row and the value of the definition at that row. And then finally, it prints it in a log message. After that, we are a good Android citizen and we close up our cursor. Okay, let's see what the output looks like. Now the app UI itself won't actually change, but if I go over here and look at the log messages, I'll see that for every single word that was in the cursor, I have that word and its definition. Hopefully this is enough about cursors to get you started. If you're looking for more information, check out the links below.